Well, good morning. Hope everybody's doing good this morning. I want to welcome you and thank you for joining us today at Community Life Church on this beautiful Sunday morning. My name is Scott Verno, and I'm the lead pastor here at Community Life, and it is an honor to have you here in our family room or have you joining us online. We thought that today, after last weekend, we had a cool event that happened last weekend, and we just want to give you a little flavor of what took place. So we gathered on Navarre Beach, and we baptized 56 people, and we want you to see some of the faces. The water was so cold that you can just see it on their faces. So turn your attention to the screen and just take a little look and see what happened last weekend. So it was interesting, right as we started baptizing, Fat Albert from the Blues Angels was flying by. You know how they always come by? And that joker went all the way out, swooped around, and came all the way back in and did a Passover on the middle of the thing. Isn't that cool? I thought it was so cool. But anyway, celebrate folks today. Love on them. It was a beautiful moment. And let me tell you something. God is doing something amazing in the hearts and lives of the people of this church and in this community. And we are so excited to see what God has in store for us. You guys ready for a great Sunday? All right, I invite you to be able to stand. And let's start the service off by praying the Lord's Prayer together. Let's do that. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Heavenly Father, we love you, and we're so grateful for opportunities to gather our hearts together, Lord, and just spend some time in worship and studying the Word. And so, God, I just pray that today, as we're here, as we're joining online, that, God, that we know that you have something in store for us. You know the things we're walking through. You know the challenges that we're facing. And, Lord, we believe that you have something to say about each and every one of those as you continue to refine and define our lives. God, we just lean into you. We love you. We trust you. And it's in the name of your Son, Jesus, we pray. Amen.
Y'all remain standing. Amen. We're going to sing a little, Come Now Is the Time to Worship. The words will be on the screen for you. You ready? Here we go. Come, now is the time to worship. Come, now is the time to give your heart. Come, just as you are, to worship. Come, just as you are before your God. Come. In one day every tongue will confess you are Lord. One day every knee will bow. Still the greatest treasure for those we will God. Gladly serve you now. One day every tongue will confess you are God. One day every knee will bow. Still the greatest treasure remains for those who gladly choose you now. Come, now is the time to worship. Now is the time to give your heart. Come, just as you are, to worship. Come, just as you are before your God. Oh, come. And one day every tongue will confess you are God. One day every knee will bow. Still the greatest treasure remains for those who gladly choose you now. One day every tongue will confess you are God. One day every knee will bow. Still the greatest treasure remains for those who gladly choose you now. Come. Now is the time to worship. Come. Now is the time to give your heart. Come. Just as you are, to worship. Come. Just as you are before your God. Oh, come. Just as you are, come. Just as you are, oh, come. Just as you are, come. Father, thank you that you're a God that we can come to just as we are. Nothing fancy, nothing formal. Just come to you and ask you for whatever we need, Lord, and you're always there to give us what we need. We thank you for that, Lord, that you're a good, good Father. We thank you for this beautiful day, Lord, and everyone that's a part of it today that's joined us this morning. Bless Jim as he delivers your word this morning from Scripture. Bless the worship team as they deliver your word in song. And bless God as he delivers our continuing series. And we'll ask all this in the precious name of your Son, Jesus Christ. Amen. You may be seated.
We didn't have those lights last week, did we? I got my shorts on, though. You also notice you didn't see my picture in any of those baptism photos. A little too cold for me. Well, good morning, everyone. We had finished going through Genesis and the life of Abraham last week, and so obviously everyone thought I was probably going to go to Exodus. No, we're going to go back to the Old and the New Testament. We're going to work our way through the books of Acts, one of my favorite books, by the way. And this book is it's the action book, if you will, of the New Testament. It's the one that gets everything moving and the blood starts to boil, and it's an exciting book. There's a lot in it. The full name of this book is the Acts of the Apostles. But we never really say that. That's too long. We just call the book Acts. In effect, though, there aren't many, really aren't many apostles that are even mentioned in this book. You got James and John, Peter and Paul, and that's probably the only men whose names appear in any prominence in this entire book of the Bible. There is intense conflict throughout this book. But it's also a conflict that is also met by a ringing confidence, if you will, about how God is acting in the lives of his church and people. And it's actually a very, very understandable book. But it's a book that we in understanding this, we are able to understand so much more of what follows. Because if you didn't have the book of Acts, I will tell you that the letters of Paul and the letter of Peter and everything else in the New Testament would not have the same connectivity, if you will. This sort of brings it all together because it fills the gaps in history between the Gospels and the book of Romans and the other books that follow that. So it's an important book. You know, at the end of the Gospels, we find that there are a handful of Jewish people gathered in Jerusalem, and they're talking about this kingdom that is supposed to come to the land of Israel. In the book of Romans, we find an apostle who is not even mentioned in the Gospels, and an apostle who is not one of the original 12. And we find in that book, he writes to a band of Christians in the capital city of Rome, and he's talking to them about the ends, going to the ends of the earth. You know, the book of Acts tells all of this takes place, because without the book of Acts, this would all seem like a lot of jumble. And it also talks about why all these things occurred as well. The first 14 verses of the very first chapter constitute probably basically what is an introduction to what we're going to be reading as we go through this thing. And here we have revealed the essential strategy, if you will, by which Jesus Christ proposes to change the entire world. The whole map is laid out in this book. You know, there are way too many Christians that are living their lives today that suffer from a very, very severe case of inferiority when they confront the world around them. And they bring about this, they have bought the idea, too many people have bought this idea that the church is old-fashioned, that the church doesn't make any sense. The church is not speaking to the needs of the day and the time. It's just not modern enough. It's not important. You know, exactly the opposite is true. The church is the most important body in the entire world today. Because whatever happens in the world happens as a result of something that is or something that is not happening in the church itself. And this strategy is given us, if you got your Bibles, we're going to start right now in Acts chapter 1, and this whole strategy is listed in the first two verses. Let's see what he has to say here. In my former book, Theophilus, I wrote about all that Jesus began to do and to teach until the day he was taken up to heaven, after giving instructions through the Holy Spirit to the apostles he had chosen. Okay, well, the writer here, although it doesn't say this right now, is Luke, our buddy Luke, who is by nature and by occupation, he is a doctor, he is a physician. He's famous because he's accompanied the Apostle Paul on a number of his missionary journeys. And we don't know a whole lot about Luke. We don't know how he became a Christian. We know he's not Jewish. He's a Gentile. But we do not know how he came to a faith in Christ. No doubt, he probably came through the ministry of his good friend Paul, because he was Paul's companion through these journeys. And those journeys involved danger, and they involved hardship, trials, tribulations, difficulties up and down and throughout the whole Roman world of the time. And he wrote two books in the New Testament, the Gospel, which bears his name, and this book that we're starting to look at today, this book of Acts. And the one to whom this book is addressed is a man by the name of Theophilus. And that's about as how much we know about him as well. We don't know anything more about him. He's not mentioned anywhere else in Scripture. He may have been maybe a sponsor of Luke who may have, you know, provided him some funds, if you will, to be able to partake of these journeys and help the spread of Christianity. We just don't know. This second book, this book of Acts, is really a confirmation of what Jesus began to do that we read about in the first four Gospels. So in a very real sense, Acts is not the Acts of the Christians. It's not the Acts of the apostles. It's the continuing Acts of Jesus Christ. It's an account of what Jesus continues to do, what he continues to preach, what he continues to harp on, what he continues to point people to. Now, in the Gospels, he did this in his physical body, in the flesh, face to face, eyeball to eyeball. In the book of Acts, he's doing it through the bodies, if you will, of men and women who are indwelt in his life and by his life. So whether in the Gospels or whether in this book of Acts, this subject of incarnation, if you will, is the secret strategy by which Jesus plans to make changes, you know, throughout the world. Whenever God wants to get a message across to men and women, he doesn't simply send someone out to announce it. He did that in the Old Testament. We notice when he used prophets to talk to the kings, to the people in charge, to the authorities, to the Sadducees, to the Pharisees. And he used people that way. But his final way of driving messages home now is to dress that message in flesh and blood, meaning he's using people who were indwelt by his Holy Spirit, who in effect have the life of Christ living within them. And he makes it very clear what he has to say by using and putting those people in circumstances. And that's really the whole strategy of how he uses and how this message of the gospel is spread throughout this book. It's the record of incarnation, men and women possessed by Jesus Christ, men and women who are owned by Jesus Christ, men and women who are manifesting the life of our Savior day to day. And that's really the secret of really what we can call authentic Christianity. It's us being and doing what Christ would have done had he been here. Anytime you find a Christianity that is not doing that, it's not a true Christianity. No matter how much it may adapt the clothing and language of Christianity, it's not the activity of human beings. If it's not the activity of humans being possessed by the Spirit of God, indwelt by the life of Christ, stay away from it. Because the power of the church, as we shall see in this book, is because men and women indwelt by the Spirit of God, living the life of Christ, are now doing the work of Christ throughout the Roman world. And when we get to the end of this book, you're going to find that this book doesn't end. There's no ending to this book. Actually, it's a little frustrating, if you will, when you get to the end of it. This book of the Bible is actually still being written, if you will. The book abruptly closes with an account of Paul in the city of Rome. He is on a house arrest. He's really in a house that he's really hiring out. He's really living there temporarily. And this book ends as though you're looking like you want to turn the next page and say, okay, now what happens next? It's almost like a mystery novel. You can't end there. There's got to be some resolution to this thing. You're not going to find it. It just ends as though you might turn the next page and begin the next adventure. Okay, what's going to happen now with Paul? Doesn't happen. This is volume one. What we're looking at today, what we're starting at today, is volume one. We're now somewhere in the future. We're on volume 30. Because the Acts of the Apostles are really, in some respects, still being written. So every good book needs a good introduction. to get us interested, to get us focused on what we're to learn, to tell us what this book is all about. And that's what we really get here. So let's go back to Acts chapter 1. Let's take a look at the next couple of verses. Verses 3 and 4, he says this. After his suffering, meaning Jesus, he showed himself to these men and gave many convincing proofs that he was alive. He appeared to them over a period of 40 days and spoke about the kingdom of God. On one occasion, while he was eating with them, he gave them this command. Do not leave Jerusalem, but wait for the gift my Father promised, which you have heard me speak about. Right away, we have Luke stressing for us the great and central fact of the Christian faith. And that fact is Jesus lives. Jesus is alive. That's how he opens this entire book. That incomparable fact is what puts Christianity 1,000 miles ahead of any other world religion. It's 1,000 miles ahead of any competitor in this field of truth, which we can call world religions. It's no surprise that for the 20 centuries of Christianity, since Christ walked this earth, enemies of the faith, enemies of Christ, enemies of those who profess to be his disciples and followers, those people are really attacking a fact. They're attacking the truth that Jesus lives. Now, they'll tell you it's nothing but hallucinations and people just talking off the top of their head, myths and so forth. We know that not to be the case. History shows that not to be the case. The Greek word for proof that's used in verse 3 that we just read about is a word that includes the idea of being convincing. Infallible is the word here. That's what the King James Version puts it. And Luke gives us here three categories of this infallibility, of these proofs. One category is that Jesus appeared to people for how many days? We just read it. 40 days. 40 days he made his presence known. And the word used here is one from which we get our word, our English word, ophthalmia. Ophthalmia. And it means the word for your eye. That's the word that's used here. It's literally the eyeball. So Luke is really saying here is that these apostles, these disciples, they had eyeballs on Jesus for not just one day, for a total of 40 days. So the eyeball is one thing. The second thing he spoke to them, he says in verse 3, he says, he spoke about the kingdom of God. Then finally, the ultimate proof was he ate with them. That's interesting that Luke would say that. He ate with them. But, you know, he's talking to us. He was giving us truth. He's talking about some very important things. What he's really saying is these apostles for 40 days saw the food disappear. It was on the plate, it went into his mouth, it was gone. He was here. We eyeballed him, we saw him. He ate with us. They knew without any doubt that Jesus was alive. You know, this marvelous fact of the resurrection of Jesus, you know it and I know it, is the bedrock upon which all Christian faith ultimately rests. And Paul tells us later on in his letters. He says, if the resurrection of Jesus Christ did not take place, it's over. It's over. We are to be pitied amongst all people because we are worshiping and have faith in a lie. It is the most important factor that ever happened on the face of this earth. Anytime you are troubled with doubts, anytime you are under attack for your faith, come back to this central fact, this fundamental fact, that Jesus was resurrected and he lives today as surely as you breathe the air today. Throughout the centuries, there's been a whole lot of people who have tried to disprove this resurrection of Jesus over and over and over again. No one has ever been successful. They can't do it. The reason being, it's not true. Jesus did rise from the dead. In fact, oftentimes the people attempting are going out and saying, my mission in life is now to disprove the resurrection of Christ. What happens to a lot of them is they become convinced that it is true because all the facts, all the evidence weighs in the favor of the fact that Jesus was resurrected. The name Lee Strobel ought to ring a bell with a number of you who wrote a book called The Case for Christ when he went out to disprove who Jesus was and that he was the Christ and that he was resurrected and that he lives within us by the Holy Spirit. He went out and researched it, came back and found out it's beyond a shadow of a doubt. He became a Christian, became a pastor. The first fact then is Jesus is alive. Eyeballs on him, we ate with him. The second historic fact is the promise of the Father. The promise of the Father. Let's go back to Acts chapter 1, starting in verse 4. On one occasion, while he was eating with them, he gave them this command: do not leave Jerusalem, but wait for the gift my Father promised, which you have heard me speak about. For John baptized with water, but in a few days you will be baptized with the Holy Spirit. So when they met together, they asked him, Lord, are you at this time going to restore the kingdom to Israel? He said to them, it is not for you to know the times or dates the Father has set by his own authority. But you will receive power when the Holy Spirit comes on you, and you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem and in all Judea and Samaria and to the ends of the earth. Literally what Jesus said to these 11 disciples was, chill out a little bit here. Stick around in Jerusalem. Stay in town. Don't be taking any trips here. Don't go outside the city until the promise of my Father has been given to you. Why would he say that? Because what he was saying is, you're going to make a mess of things if you go out and try to witness without allowing the Holy Spirit to come into your life first. This is an absolute essential. You cannot be an effective Christian, is what he's saying. Not only to them, he's saying it to us too. You cannot be an effective Christian if you are not operating in the power of God's Holy Spirit. So he's saying, don't try anything without the Spirit. Stay in time. Don't go anywhere. Wait, because in a few days, this is all going to come about. You are going to receive this promise that the Father has given you. If you get further along in the Bible, you get in back into the book of Galatians, if you will. The third chapter of this book that Paul wrote to the churches in Galatia, Paul tells us that this was the promise. Verses 13 and 14 of Galatians says, Christ redeemed us from the curse of the law by becoming a curse for us, for it is written, cursed is everyone who is hung on a tree. He redeemed us in order that the blessing given to Abraham might come to the Gentiles through Christ Jesus, so that by faith we might receive the promise of the Spirit. God promised Abraham the Spirit. He promised him the Spirit, and through him to give the blessing to everyone who believed, Jew and Gentile alike. So that raises a question. It says, you know, does that mean that no one ever received the Holy Spirit until this day of Pentecost that we read about in the book of Acts. Even though the promise was given to Abraham 2,000 years before this, is that what that means? When you read your Bible, there is no record of any Gentile believer ever receiving the Holy Spirit until the day of Pentecost. What we read about it and what we're going to read about in Acts chapter 2 was unique. It's the first time the Holy Spirit had been given to Gentiles, at least what Scripture tells us. We can't find it anywhere else. No record. In the Old Testament, the Holy Spirit works in the Old Testament, though. The Old Testament, we see the Holy Spirit being given to select individuals, select Israelites, to accomplish God's purposes. We see that. You see that with Samson. You see it with Gideon. You see it with Moses. You see it with all the major characters. They are indwelt by the Holy Spirit because they are out to do God's purposes. But we also find out that the Spirit never remains on that person after the purpose of God has been fulfilled. Go back and read about the story of Saul and how that Spirit was taken away from him. Some 2,000 years after the celebration of Pentecost, the Holy Spirit is given now to us today, immediately when people come to a faith, by faith, in belief in Jesus. When that happens, there's no necessarily any feeling that goes with it. There's no celebration. There's no emotional lift. For the most part, there's no indication of it that you can sense with your five senses as to the change that has come about in your life. It occurs, just as Jesus said it would, to any person who believes in him. And it's the means by which the risen life of Jesus becomes available to you and becomes available to me. Continuously, all the time, constantly, forever. And all that is made available to us, those of us who have professed that faith. And that also means something to this. That means that we can have every bit of God's attentions, of Christ's attention, all the time. All the time. All that He is is available to us all the time. We don't have to share Him with anyone else. He's yours. He is looking at you. He is talking to you. He is relating to you, and everything that He is, we have every second of every day. And this is why it was so important for the Holy Spirit to come, because it means by the Spirit that Jesus' life is made available in each one of us. While Jesus walked this earth, He was 100% God and 100% man, but He was limited to His presence. That's all changed when He was resurrected. That's why it's so key. His life lives, and that living of the life of Christ is now available to you today, to me today, to everyone in faith today. And notice that Jesus points out that not only is this not ritual, but it is a reality. It's not a program. It's a power that has been placed inside of you. So these disciples asked Him questions. They always asked Him questions. They asked Him if He was now going to restore the kingdom. You know, this was foremost on their minds all the way through the ministry. They were always thinking, well, this Messiah is going to, you know, bring this kingdom. So right away, one of the first things they asked Him is now the time? Are we going to do it now? They were thinking in terms of charts, of Gantt schedules. They were looking for a program. They wanted to see the progress. They want to see the schedule of events, if you will. What had to take place now and take place next week? And, okay, can I get the big picture here? When is it going to happen? When is it going to, how's it going to happen? I want to know that. I'd like to see how, I'd like to see the plan. Give me the blueprint. And the Lord responded, that's not for you to know. He says, your task is to be the manifestation of power, not the knowledge of a program. Big difference here. He says the Father is going to take care of all of that. Don't concern yourself. Content yourself with exercising the power that has been given you and rely on the Father to sort of put it all together. He's given him some very, very good advice. But I want to tell you, that's also what the church has not paid attention to over the years. The church, the church over the years has thought it had the task of programming the work of God. We're going to program this thing. And we're going to try to carry it out consistently. And we're going to carry out this program systematically, no matter whether we're here in the United States or we're going to go around the world to do it. But you know what? That's not our purpose as the church. It's not our job. It's not in your job description. It's not in any church's job description. What Jesus said was that the time and the seasons are not for us to know, but that we're going to receive power on high when the Holy Spirit's come upon us. That's the limitations. We're going to receive power. But don't get hung up on understanding or trying to figure it all out. And the power he is talking about is the power of a risen Lord, the power of a resurrected life, a resurrected perfection, if you will. It's a quiet power. It's the kind that never makes a sound, doesn't make any great demonstrations. It's a power that changes life from within a person, not changing the outward appearance. It's all internally driven. It's a power that does not separate. It does not divide. It unifies. It harmonizes. It's a power that heals. And that's what you receive when you receive this gift that has been promised, this Holy Spirit. And then John, Jesus says, we will be his witnesses, you and I. Christians are not like salesmen. We're not like salesmen going out to pitch a product, going door to door, telling people, this is what you really need. Nor are we recruiters going around from house to house or neighborhood to neighborhood, trying to get people to join our religious club. That's not us either. When the church does those types of things, it has become false. It's lost its power. Because the church does not have power to do that. That power is reserved. The mark of a false church is that it loves to talk about itself. Now, these early Christians never witnessed. If you take a look at the witnessing of these early Christians, they never witnessed about the church at all, about how well we're doing. Look at all the widows we're feeding. Look at the programs we put in. They don't talk about that. What they talk about is the Lord Jesus Christ, not the church. It talks about what the Lord Jesus Christ could do, what he has done, what he will do, what a fantastic person he was, what a great teacher he was, how amazing his power was, how he changed lives, how he brought people back from the dead, what he can do in the normal human heart from the inside out. That's what they talked about. You know, too often churches find themselves talking about themselves with eyes focused on themselves, but that was not what we learned from the early church. The early church's eyes were focused on the Lord Jesus Christ, witnessing to who he was, talking about him, talking about him, talking about him. There's another thing that will run throughout the rest of this book as we go through it, and that's the hope of Christ's return. Go back to Acts chapter 1, verses 9 through 11. After Jesus had said this, he was taken up before their very eyes, and a cloud hid him from their sight. They, meaning the apostles, were looking intently up into the sky as he was going, when suddenly two men dressed in white stood beside them. "Men of Galilee," they said, "why do you stand here looking into the sky? This same Jesus who has been taken from you into heaven will come back in the same way you have seen him go into heaven." Wow! Wouldn't you have loved to have been there on that day? Man, that would have been exciting. As they were standing on the Mount of Olives, they saw him suddenly lift and ascend into a cloud. Now, Jesus told them this was going to happen. He told them this before, because in the Gospel of John, Jesus says, quote, It is to your advantage that I go away, for if I do not go away, the Comforter, the Holy Spirit, will not come to you. But if I do go away, I will send him to you. And Jesus did not go to some far-off star or planet in this universe in space. Jesus simply stepped into a different dimension of reality, of true existence, the spiritual kingdom, which surrounds us on every side. It's invisible to us, but it's not far away, and he is not far away. The throne of God is not far away. And the greatness of his presence and power is very, very close. That invisible life is imparted to us by the Holy Spirit, who came as a result of Jesus leaving this earth. And because he went, you and I can have all of him all of the time, not just when he's standing in front of us in a physical body. Now, the angels tell us that though he was going away, his return wasn't problematic. It was absolutely certain. They said, "This same Jesus who has been taken from you into heaven will come back in the same way you have seen him go into heaven." So just as Jesus stepped into invisibility at that time, he is going to, in the future, step back into visibility when he returns, and all eyeballs are going to see him. Suddenly, just like that, he is going to be back. And when he comes, says other scriptures, a lot of things are going to change. He is going to remove the curse on this earth and on this world and on the hearts and minds of people. He's going to remove that curse from all of nature. Everything is going to be made exactly the way he wants it to be made. Until that happens, things are going to get worse. You know that, and I know that. We feel it all around us. The problems we face are not going away. Jesus said that the tribulation of the last days before his return were going to be ugly. He says they were going to be so intense, they're going to be so terrible, they're going to be so frightening, that no one would be saved if it were not for the intervention of God into this earth and into our lives. But he says God is going to intervene. That's a promise. He's coming. When Jesus comes again, he removes the curse. Nature will bloom and blossom just like it did with Adam and Eve. Death and decay, gone, defeated. God will draw back the curtains on an exciting thing that he's been creating. He's been creating this behind the scenes. We can't see it. He's putting this all together, getting it all ready to go. He's been creating behind the scenes for 21 centuries, and he's creating a new humanity. He's getting ready for it. And we're going to be part of it. New kind of man, new kind of woman is going to be revealed when he returns. That's what Paul says. He says in one of his books, he says, the creation waits in eager expectation for the sons of God to be revealed. All the world is waiting for this. All the world is waiting for his return. It is the signpost. It's the most important thing that's ever going to happen. And that hope of his return runs like a thread throughout this book they're going to be looking over for the next few weeks. It also runs throughout the course of church history as well. It's part and parcel of the mystery of the incarnation. It's part and parcel of this grand strategy, this plan, this program that God employs. Take a look at the last part of this section of Scripture. Go back to Acts chapter 1. Take a look at verses 12 through 14. Then they returned, meaning the disciples, they returned to Jerusalem from the hill called the Mount of Olives, a Sabbath day's walk from the city. So it was very close. When they arrived, they went upstairs to the room where they were staying. Those present were Peter, John, James, and Andrew, Philip and Thomas, Bartholomew and Matthew, James, son of Alphaeus, and Simon the Zealot, and Judas, son of James. They all joined together constantly in prayer, along with the women and Mary, the mother of Jesus, and with his brothers. They went back to Jerusalem and did the only thing that was left for them to do, the only thing they could do, because they were told not to leave, don't get involved, wait. So the only thing they could do was pray. The only thing that was available to them, prayer. So what did they do? They prayed. Prayer is always both the first and the final resort of the people of God. Start with prayer, end with prayer, pray continually. Here were these people. They were deprived of the physical presence of Jesus. They had to be hurting as a result of that. The Spirit had not yet been given, so they did not have his indwelling presence, his life. But at the same time, they were not cut off from God. They were still linked to him by this marvelous communication piece called prayer. They're waiting for the full revelation of what God had in mind to give them. They knew it was coming, just didn't know when. So from this, we see that prayer is always an absolutely essential part of the life of you and me, of every person who, by faith, professes Christ as Lord and Savior. It's part of the strategy by which the incarnate Christ touches and changes the world. He does it through us. So here is the introduction. We have all these elements, if you see in this introduction, that made up the book of Acts. It's made up of a risen Lord, a resurrected Lord whose life is made available through the coming and giving of the Holy Spirit, who will come in absolute total power and great glory, but with whom we are yet in constant communication by means of the prayers that we offer. So we're sort of connected here, really close. We've only gone through 14 chapters of Acts, and really I've given you the whole book of Acts. Because we're going to see this in every chapter that we go through. These factors are the things that drive this entire book. Prayer. The recognition of the power. The recognition of who we are. The recognition that it's not our program. It's the power that we can wield to make that program happen when he calls for it to take place. So my prayer for us is that we not be the church that points fingers inside, that we don't become church peddlers, that we become people who always are focused and pointing to the Lord Jesus Christ. That we live into what our mission statement is, to connect people to Jesus. We do that not by pointing to the church, we point to Him. You bow your heads with me? Lord, we thank You for this book of Acts, which we really just get started with today, but we can see where we're going to be going. And Lord, when You left this earth and when You ascended into heaven, You had 11 very, very broken, wounded men and women left behind to continue to point to You. And that shows us how powerful this Spirit is, because when that Spirit came on Pentecost, these people changed dramatically. So Lord, allow us to view this book as a primer, if you will, about how we live our lives. That the power that they possess is the power we possess. The mission that they have is the mission we have, to go into all the world, proclaiming the gospel, baptizing, and bringing people to faith in Jesus Christ. Lord, I thank You for this message. I thank You for the gospel writer and the writer of Acts, Luke, for his faithfulness and for his diligence. Thank You for using him as You use us. In Christ's name we pray. Amen.